morning. I do not like mornings.
Amen.
Especially Saturday mornings when I have to get up for a train that leaves at 6:20. And yesterday, besides getting up, it's still dark, get on a train that's going to Orange County, leaving here at 6:20. It was so I could go do my mother-in-law's taxes and my sister-in-law's taxes. There is nothing good about that day. Okay, after it was all said and done, about 4:30, we did go to a nice Mexican restaurant, and my mother-in-law paid for it, so that was nice. So that kind of made up for it.
Did you get a receipt?
Huh?
It's her tax account receipt.
Yes. Anyway, yeah, my least favorite. Today we'll be looking at Romans chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. Now remember, the theme of Paul's letter is contained in chapter 1, verses 16 through 17. What?
Nothing. Just keep talking.
What did I do wrong?
You did nothing wrong. Sorry. Just keep talking.
I'll try.
Sorry. I'll look you up.
Yes. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. Because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. A righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it's written, the righteous will live by faith. That's the theme of Paul's letter to the Romans. And remember our immediate context from verse 18, same chapter. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness, I get it, and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. And then in chapter 2, verse 1, you therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself because you who pass judgment do the very same things. So Paul is setting up his readers, reminding them that, and he wants us to understand, that we're doomed as doomed can be. That is, there's nothing we can do to fix the situation that we find ourselves in. It's beyond hope. That is, God has us under his condemnation. It's almost like the Emo Phillips joke. Why be prejudiced against anyone because of their race or nationality or creed when there are so many real reasons to hate others? And this is the condition that the human race is in. That is, we stand condemned before God. And this is the point that Paul's trying to make in this section of his letter. And it's not that God hates us, of course. Quite the opposite, in fact. He shows his love to all of us regardless. But we aren't to that part of Romans yet. We're still in the part where it's harsh and judgmental and we're in trouble. If you recall our foray into the book of Ecclesiastes many long months ago, it ends in chapter 12 with this statement, verses 13 and 14. Now, all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Be afraid of God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty or the sum total of what it means to be human. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it's good or bad. Now, that's not a positive, happy statement. It means that whether you're good or bad, God is going to get you. This is the point, and that's the point that Paul is making here in this section that we're going to look at today. So let's go ahead and read Romans chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. All who sin apart from the law will also perish apart from the law. And all who sin under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but it is those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. Indeed, when Gentiles who do not have the law do by nature things required by the law, they are a law for themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them and at other times even defending them. This will take place on the day when God judges people's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. Let's pray. Father, help us as we look through this section, help us to keep in mind the context, help us to remember what Paul's point and purpose in all of this is. In Jesus' name, amen. All who sin apart from the law will also perish apart from the law, and all who sin under the law will be judged by the law. So if you sin apart from the law, you're in trouble. If you sin knowing the law, you're going to be judged. No matter what, you're in trouble. And whether you know what God expects from you, whether you know all the commandments of the law, you're going to have trouble. Now, how many laws are there in the five books of Moses, the Pentateuch, the Torah? 613. There's 613 laws. You would be hard-pressed, probably, to be able to list them off. If I were to call on any of you, would you be able to list them for me? Actually, if you quickly go to Wikipedia, type in 613 commandments, they'll have them all there. Except, those are the list, that's the list that Rabbi Moses Maimonides came up with. Now, other rabbis have slightly different lists of laws that you have to keep. And of those 613 laws, not all of them are still operative. That is, some of them are only for men, some of them are only for women, some of them only work if you are in the land of Israel, some of them are not operative anymore at all because there's no temple. Some of them depend on the time of the year that you're dealing with, and you got to keep all of that straight. Yeah. It's said that all of us, every day, break certain federal regulations and probably state laws. And we could all end up in jail at any given moment because we're all constantly breaking the law. And of course, these 613 laws in the five books of Moses, we're also breaking probably a number of them. How many of you have had shellfish recently? Say you're in trouble. You're not allowed to do that. Probably some of your clothing has more than one type of, it's not just all cotton or all wool or all nylon. It's probably a mixture of things, so you can't do that. So you're in trouble. You're condemned. And that's Paul's point. That is, you're condemned. There's no way that you're going to be able to keep all the laws. That is, you could go online and download all the federal regulations, however many thousands and thousands and thousands of pages, and spend your days memorizing and learning those things so you can never break any of those commandments. And you could spend all your time reading the Pentateuch to make sure you don't break any of those commandments. In the office, church office there, you've got the complete Talmud. And the Talmud is the commentary by rabbis on the five books of Moses. And they spend their entire time discussing all those 613 commands. And so you'll have Rabbi Hillel say, okay, what this command means, you have to do these certain things. And then they'll say right after that, but Rabbi Eva says that if you listen to Rabbi Hillel, you're doomed. So you're in trouble no matter what. You cannot keep the law. You're not going to succeed at doing that. And that's part of Paul's point. You are going to perish. You're doomed, as doomed can be. Making and keeping laws is hard. Alexander the Great, so the story goes, conquered a group of people in Persia. And he told them, I want you to gather up the dead bodies from the battle and burn them. And the people were horrified. You can't do that. We can't burn the bodies. That would be desecrating fire. We can't possibly do that. Allow us to eat the bodies instead.
Oh, you.
And so Alexander said, okay, fine. Go ahead. Another battle. Another part of the world. He tells the people afterwards, I want you to gather up the bodies and eat them. Of course, they're horrified. Laws, no matter what, you cannot keep all the laws and regulations. Righteousness does not come from keeping laws. It's not a matter of if your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds. He doesn't say you can pay a penalty, maybe some added interest costs, make it all up and they'll be okay. Paul says, if you sin, you will perish. There's no ifs, no ands, no buts. You will be judged. He doesn't specify the sin. He doesn't say if it's a little sin, well, that's okay. If it's a big sin, though, you're really in trouble. How do you determine what's a big sin and what's a little sin? You go to Numbers chapter 15. You have a little story there of a guy that one Saturday morning, it's really sucked, and for him, this day really went bad. He goes out and he starts gathering up some firewood and sticks. He gets noticed. He gets hauled before Moses. What are we going to do with this guy? He's desecrating the Sabbath. He's picking up sticks on the Sabbath. Stone him to death. Stoning someone to death for picking up sticks on a Saturday morning. Huh? And then they had to pick up rocks, yes, and stone him. But that's okay. You can stone someone on the Sabbath, you just can't pick up rocks on the Sabbath. It's like the disciples getting in trouble because they were gleaning and harvesting when they were pulling the wheat off the stalks as they're walking through the fields and eating them. Can't do that. Desecrates the Sabbath. So no matter what, you cannot possibly be good enough to satisfy whatever it is that God wants. And it's a little hard to figure it out as you look through these 613 commands. And with the rabbis arguing about what they mean, and yeah, you're in trouble. Romans chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but it is those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. Indeed, when Gentiles do not have the law, do by nature things required by the law, they are a law for themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them, and at other times even defending them. So just hearing the law does not bring righteousness. You have to obey it in order to be declared righteous. And Gentiles without the law can sometimes obey the law. So, if you want to be righteous, then you have to do the law. And of course, you have to then figure out what the law is. Now, in the New Testament, we even see this reflected, for instance, in James chapter 1, verses 22 through 25. Do not merely listen to the word, and so deceive yourselves, do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they'll be blessed in what they do. Or chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. It's one of my favorite passages. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself is not accompanied by action is dead. Just hearing the law, just knowing what it says, not adequate. And of course, even knowing the law, again, those 613 laws, trying to memorize them all would be very difficult. And of course, James goes on and says, you believe there is one God? Good. Even the demons believe that. And of course, it doesn't do them a whole lot of good. They're still doomed. But Paul wants his readers to understand that just having access to the Bible, just knowing about it, is not good enough and does not make us special. The question, of course, is, do we do it? Jesus said, anyone who loves me will obey my teaching, John chapter 14. And he said in John chapter 15, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. Our Jesus commands the 613 laws of the Torah. Is that what he's talking about? No, it's not what he's talking about. If you look a little bit further on, well, to go back to the Beatitudes that we looked at a while ago, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven, causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Or not even the tax collectors doing that. And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Well, that doesn't help any either. I find it very easy to love people that are nice to me. That is, there's nobody in this room that, you know, I have any particular problems with. That is, none of you beat me or hit me or kick me in the shins or do anything nasty and uncomfortable to me. So I love you, no problem. But there are other people that I really have trouble tolerating, even. That just annoy me constantly. That is, people that are mean to my children. It's very hard to love someone that's mean to my children. If someone's mean to my wife, I'd be very hard-pressed to feel warm fuzzies towards them. If someone would be mean to any of you, it would really bother me. I would have trouble loving that person. Yet that's what Jesus tells us. We're supposed to love those that are unlovely, love those that are hard to love, love politicians. Yeah, and how do we do that? How do we love a politician or a lawyer? But that's what we are asked to do, is to love people. Not the people I like, not the people that make me happy, but even the people that make me unhappy. Now, you know, there's a tiny bit of hope if I look at, say, Psalms 136. Psalm 136, it has this repeated phrase, for his love endures forever. And it starts out, you know, making sense, you know, his love endures forever. He divided the Red Sea asunder. His love endures forever. He brought Israel through the midst of it. His love endures forever. And then the bit of hope are the more imprecatory sections about it. That is, the kind of love that I would like to give to people like politicians and lawyers. That is, he swept Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. His love endures forever. To him who struck down great kings, his love endures forever. And killed mighty kings, his love endures forever. Sihon, king of the Amorites, his love endures forever. And Og, king of Bashan, his love endures forever. That's the kind of love we'd like to give. I'd like to give that love to several people that I know. Probably not what Jesus intended either. Matthew 21. 28 through 32, the parable that Jesus said, told Matthew 21, 28 through 32. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. The tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe. So this is the chief priests and the elders that were shown the way to righteousness. People that knew the law, did the law, and it's the tax collectors and the prostitutes, the last people in the world you would expect that are the truly righteous ones, according to Jesus. Now, if you look at what Paul says, those you'd expect to be okay with God, the ones who have access to the law, just hearing the law, have a familiarity with the law, that's never quite enough. Doing it is what counts. And Paul says regarding the Gentiles, those without the law, they are a law for themselves, and it's written on their hearts, and their consciences also bearing witness. It's like what he told the audience in Athens, pagans, idolaters, philosophers. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own quotes have said, we are his offspring. This week, Eric Miller on his Facebook page had a quotation from Billy Graham, which I liked. It was, it's God's job to judge, the Spirit's job to convict, and our job to love. And we dare not mix those up. Paul is very much aware of this, and we tend to forget about it far too easily, imagining that we have to tell people all about their sin and make them feel bad about it. But Paul writes here, they show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them, and other times even defending them. Jesus said it's the Spirit that convicts the world of sin in John chapter 16, verses 7 through 11. So we don't really need to worry about that. People understand that they are sinners. That seems to not be that hard. Most of us understand we're not quite perfect. So the bottom line, the overall context remains. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people. This is true for those that have the Bible as much as for those who don't, for both Jew and Gentile alike. We cannot keep the law. The law instead serves to remind us of our inadequacy. If righteousness could be found in keeping the law, and only by keeping the law, then we would all be doomed. As Paul wrote to the church in Galatia, I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. And then the author of Hebrews said in chapter 10, verse 4, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. That is, the law is constantly and always and forever going to be inadequate to take care of the problem that we're facing. All the law serves to do is to remind us that we're not making it. We're not able to fix our own problems. And so, chapter 2 of Romans, verse 16, you have the interesting phrase, this will take place on the day when God judges people's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my good news declares. This will happen when God judges the secrets of people through Jesus Christ. What does that mean? How does that work? It's actually not that complicated. My good news, what was the good news that Paul proclaimed? That Jesus paid the price, paid the penalty, that all was by grace through faith. God judges people's secrets, their actions. How? Through Jesus Christ, not through them. That is, God judges us through Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is actually perfect. And so that's what makes things okay for us. That is, Jesus gets judged instead of us. Over and over again, it's obvious from what Paul is saying, the conclusion that he wants everyone to hear, the good news is that Jesus Christ solved our problems for us, and we are now free and clear. Again, Paul's theme, in chapter 1, verses 16 through 17, we've always got to keep this theme in mind as we go through the book of Romans. And I'll end on this. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last. Just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the time we've had this morning together. We'd ask that you bless each of us as we go out from here. Bless our time now when we go to the business meeting later. In Jesus' name, amen.